For those of you who don't know, I'm studying illustration at Brigham Young University in Utah. And today I wanted to share with you what I learned from composition class. This is basically a quick summary of a semester-long class. This class wasn't just about drawing, it was about art in general, including design, photography, etc. So you can apply these principles to basically any art. Imagine art as a house. Today I will be talking not about the basement, but the ground under the basement. So yeah, these six principles are the core of any art, and if you get them right, that's a great start. So let's start. What makes an artwork interesting, visually pleasing, and just beautiful? First, harmony, balance, hierarchy, rhythm, dynamics, depth and volume. And now we'll talk about each of them separately. First one, harmony. It's something like unity. An important side note, all of these principles aren't only visual, they can be ideological or informational. A piece of art can be harmonious visually, because of color or composition. However, a piece of art can have this unity or harmony if all its elements work towards one goal, which can be to tell a story, to highlight a certain element, or share an idea. In other words, harmony is when unity of all elements as a whole is more important than different elements by themselves. The whole landscape should be more important than a certain tree in it. For example, Molly Stannard has this amazing art series. If you look at every piece, you will see a lot of secondary elements, but all of them are there for a reason. For example, all items around the room tell us more about the character's past and create a certain mood. This is ideological harmony. If we will look at them from visual point of view, we will see that all of the items around the room fit right into the color palette of an art: pink, purple, and yellow. If we look at the whole series, all pieces fit together because they all have the same theme, an alternative reality, and even a symbol that is repeated everywhere, which is a university logo as I understand. The next principle, balance, is about distribution of visual and even ideological weight. This is a good example of distribution of visual weight. The character in a red chair is balanced out with the red sofa on the left. If we take the sofa out, the piece will lean towards the right too much. Here's another example. It's a similar situation, but instead of balancing the girl out by something light on the left, the balance is achieved by placing some ideological or informational weight. The casket on the left has information on her past. This important information adds weight to the left side of the piece. It's important to know that there are different kinds of balance, not just symmetrical or asymmetrical. There are some less popular kinds of balance out there. For example, radial and crystallographic. They're not as popular, but still very useful. One more important note. All of the principles can work both ways. Balance or unity make your art better if they are in harmony with your idea. Sometimes the idea is better conveyed if there is no balance or no unity in the piece. For example, if your goal is to communicate a feel of uneasiness, chaos, or just movement. It's good to know how shifted balance can tell something. For example, the more you move the balance up and close to borders, the more movement it will imply. The more centered, the more stable and peaceful. Distribution of weight is one of the basic principles of composition, so I will talk more about it when I make a video on it. The next principle is hierarchy. What is the accent of a piece? Hierarchy exists to help viewers to tell right away which elements are the most important, which are secondary, and it helps to lead their eyes in the right order. If there are no main elements, a piece will look like a pattern, because nothing in particular will catch the viewer's eye. Sometimes artworks have many main elements, for example here, the palm tree, the swing, and the house with the lifeboat. And again, hierarchy only makes your art better if it helps your idea. Here, there is no goal to distinguish any of the characters, because the goal is to show equality, so they all are equally important, or in other words, there is no hierarchy. If needed, the accent can be created visually, by using colors or contrast. Or you can make an accent by using something that attracts the eye by default. A human figure, a glance into the camera, or interaction between people. All of these create an accent right away. The next principle is a little harder to understand because we're used to hearing about it in music, but not in visual art. It's rhythm. But it's a little easier to understand if we know that it consists of two main things: contrast and repetition. Contrast gives diversity and interest, and repetition gives it structure. So rhythm is repetitive elements that can be colors, objects, etc. that tie artwork together and at the same time separate it into sections. There are several kinds of rhythm: alternating, progressive, and polyrhythmical. You don't need to remember their names, but do remember that conscious use of them can make your art a lot more interesting. You can see it very well in this artwork, where white colors create contrast and repetition, or in other words, visual rhythm. However, rhythm can be ideological, if considered in a comic or a movie or some kind of art that is longer than one moment. They can have a recurring theme or alternating moments of peace and distress, for example. Next important principle is movement or static. I'm sure that you're familiar with obvious dynamics of characters or objects that are moving. I want to introduce a less obvious kind of movement. Movement of a viewer's eye that can be enforced artistically. That's hard to describe without an example, so here is Ulrich's art. The piece is pretty static, but because of his skillful use of shapes and lines, our eye travels through the piece following these shapes and lines. That creates dynamic. And again, use it wisely, only if you need dynamics. Statics is also a good tool. Well, I will not dwell too much on dynamics and will jump into the last principle, depth. It creates a feel of volume or layers. It kind of makes your art more real. Depth is sometimes called volume, but they're a little different. Volume is more about elements, and depth is more about the whole piece. Both can make your art better, and both are not necessary. It's interesting how depth can be created in an artwork that doesn't have volume of elements. For example, here. Depth is created here by a really cool technique that I'm not sure if it has this name, but I call it the principle of three layers. So basically, to have depth in your work, you need to have three layers: close, far, and infinity. Of course, you can make more, or less, if you want a feel of a lockdown. And this is it for now. These principles can seem pointless or obvious, but knowing about them can really help you understand art better and what makes it special. It will also help you to better analyze others and your artwork, which for sure will make you a more conscious artist. Also, as I already said, all of these principles can be visual, ideological, and informational, which is plus two dimensions to your art. A little later, I will post a video about 6 tools that you can use to successfully use these 6 principles. So wait for a little, keep drawing, and don't slouch!